Happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you. It's
okay. Allow me to gift you.
Ah, so thank you so much.
You're welcome. Okay, I'll gift you as well.
Oh, thank you so much.
And David also wants to gift.
I'm not gifting you.
So we are joined by a gentleman who does not believe in love, and we're joined by a gentleman who believes
first,
in love.
First, but let me first make this very, very clear. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to be part of this flurry of celebrate Valentine's with your mother, with your... No. I think that's... If you don't have a lover, don't disturb our day. You just... It's okay. You go and work, go home, just read like an ordinary day.
We hope you'll have a change of mind by the time you're done.
The first question I have to you, for you today is where we have Father's Day. Mm. We have Mother's Day. We have Children's, whatever, everything day. Why do we want to confuse Valentine's Day, which is clearly for lovers, with now celebrate my Valentine is my mother, my Valentine is my grandmother?
But even in English, lovers.
Ah.
Lovers is about love. You mean you can't love your parents, you can't love your siblings? Love has got different types. If we have love for the opposite sex, sometimes these days it's not always the opposite sex. But if it's about love, let it be love. What's wrong with showing love to your mother? Valentine's Day is the day of love.
Mm-hmm.
Father's Day, you talked of Father's Day. Every day is Father's Day because you have to be a father all the time. But what's wrong with identifying one day and saying, let us recognize the role of fathers in society and we give it to them? 26th of January is a day of the movement. Does the movement roll only on one day? They transcend, they take over every aspect of our life. But we say, okay, this is the day that we've given to them. So with love, love takes day and night, non-stop, 24-hour effort. But just one day for lovers to call back to mind, to think about their progress, to sit down and say, how far are we going? Are we on the right path? What is going wrong? To have no excuse but focus on themselves. Does it mean that other days are not for love?
So in other words, what you're saying, Valentine's is not about buying chocolate and all these flowers that people are
battling
the studio with, but it's about sitting down on a table and reevaluating your love.
Sitting down, I used it like figuratively. Love is about everything. It's about gifting. It's about commitment. It's about romance. It's about going out. It's about all those things that will enhance your expression of love.
Dr. Love, come on. We go out every single weekend with Madame.
Thank you, congratulations.
Why do we have to now start littering? KCC is going to have a very hard job cleaning the city today just because people have decided to go out and buy flowers that they can buy on any other day.
We pay them for that. Let them clean the city. But you see, let me tell you, if you go out for love every weekend, by the way, you should do it every day. Don't wait for weekend.
No,
whenever possible. I have a job.
It's not good to allocate days
for love. Let love reign. But it's not that when you have love on Valentine's Day, you can't have love there's other days. So it's just good that much as Christians pray every day, they have a Sunday
that they go to church.
You may not even go to church, but you know that this is our day that, as they say, that the Lord has made. So this is a lover's day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad.
Let's rest it because you have to spoil the day for us who believe in love. Dr. Hillary has said let love reign, and in regards to love reigning, we are going to go to the biggest conversation this morning.
I'm going to let it reign.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's go back to where this whole Valentine's thing came from.
Yes.
This morning we were going through the details of Valentine.
Mm.
This was a saint that tried to convert a certain emperor.
Mm-hmm.
And he was beheaded.
Yes.
So where is the love?
I've told people before, society is dynamic. Whatever started in its original form ends up differently depending on the needs and aspirations of the people. I give an example of Christianity. Easter. celebrates the death of Jesus. On that day, they killed Jesus. He was not popular. He was a criminal. It was a day when finally this man was confusing people, was put to death, and people went about and rested in peace. Later, the disciples went and did their work, and Christianity came. Now, the Christianity we celebrate today is not the death of a criminal.
First point to Valentine.
It has transformed. Now, even with Valentine's, whatever started, even Christianity, Christmas, by the way, Jesus was not born on 25th of December. It was actually a pagan day. But over time, it transformed, and whatever fits society, society has the liberty of transforming it into what they want and what works for them. So Valentine's Day gave us a name.
Right.
Gave us an identity. It changed, transformed into love. Over the time, people tried to commercialize it. But in spite of that, love transcends, love reigns. It comes at in spring in Europe, actually in most cases at the equinox, when the hours of the night are equal to the hours of the day, and it was celebrated as a spring, a good day, a goddess of love. So it goes there, then it transforms. It does not matter how it came, how it started.
So
what matters
is,
are we using it? Is it working for us? Uh-huh. Is it convenient? So we go ahead.
We don't look. We are all smiling.
I can see you're trying to impress the ladies. I'm not impressed.
I'm trying to put things right, right, not to impress.
Thank you so much, Dr. Love, for trying to help David understand that love reigns. And love doesn't only reign on Valentine's Day, but every single day it reigns. And on this particular day, girlfriends are celebrating boyfriends, boyfriends are celebrating girlfriends, wives are celebrating husbands, and husbands are celebrating wives. But the biggest question that a number of people in our society today are asking is, where do you pick that perfect partner from? There's when a church was the place to go to find the wife of your dreams. Mm. The husband, the morally upright husband who would be there at your beck and call to hold the children in church, and you'd have the beautiful family. But over time, when you tell someone, oh, my husband, we met in church. What? You met in church? Ogwe. That one. Oyo. No. So where does someone pick the perfect partner from?
It's funny, you make it appear as if it's a garden.
There's a certain distinction.
A garden, you go and pick a banana, or it's a supermarket, you go and pick something. You know, it's like, let me give you an African proverb. A papyrus stays in the water, but it doesn't make it a crocodile. So does a crocodile. The two are worlds apart. Getting a good partner has nothing to do with location where you find them. I go to church, but I go to the bar also. So if you find me in a bar and you find me in church, I am the same person. Mm-hmm. And so you've had, there is a pastor now who is in prison for having what? Raped someone. Mm-hmm. Pastors are found in church, not so.
Right.
So if you went to church, you would find so many people. Where do you get a partner? Partners, ideally, are supposed to be got from interaction, because we are walking billboards announcing our genes, announcing our qualities. So if someone looks at my billboard and likes my height, likes my what, they will find a reason to evolve somehow closer to me. Then we shall know each other's names, we shall talk, chit-chat. If I also like what I see, then I get closer and I start looking, because everyone has a quality, a good quality, which you don't see unless you pay attention. So there are things which bring us closer, like beauty, like figure, like walking style. All those reflect the genetic component a person has. And if those genes are what I need, I will naturally pay close attention and eventually know the name, know the look. Then we will start talking. We will start paying attention to each other closer. Then we shall know other qualities that are not visible from afar. Mm. Once I know that these are the qualities I want, then we start from there, regardless of whether I found you in a bar or in church. Because if you know that good wives are found in church, if I want a husband, why wouldn't I go there and be there until I get?
Then, doctor,
location for me is
not something of importance. Let's look at love practically. Love is sweet and can also be very bitter. We've seen families killing each other, going to that extent, people who were actually in love as they began, like you're saying, doesn't matter where they met, but that relationship was brewed over time. So at what point does, number one, love become so bitter that people now start harming each other? And then at what point does, number two, love becomes something that is not so important anymore, and we're seeing a majority now being unfaithful to their partners? Because where they started was a love point. So how does it now metamorphosize to becoming something that is actually painful and bitter?
That's a very good question. First of all, love is like life. Once you come into life, you're going to get the ups and the downs. The reason why they become notable in love is that we invest our emotions, our resources, our time, our commitment, and our life, our future hopes in someone. That's not a comfortable place to be, because you lose your independence. But you have to do it, because that is love. Love is spiritual. It has physical elements, and some people who cannot enjoy love to the full are tipping the game in the physical. They are somehow blocking the spiritual, because either they were hurt before, or they don't have time to. But once they allowed the love to play its spiritual role, it binds you to a commitment. You see, ultimately people are supposed to be together eventually and stay together for the purpose of rearing the future generation. Human beings are very different, and it is worse when you look at their upbringing, their upbringing, their education, their cultures, the philosophy of life. So when they meet, they are two different people trying to be one. There are so many clashes, so many inconveniences that need to adjust. All that need a fuel to cement, to make it possible, and that fuel is love. Without love, you'll never fit in someone's life. So now, then love comes in. After investing all that and someone disappoints you, the reaction of that love depends on many things. It can depend on age, it can depend on experience, it can depend on the investment you have put in. So we find love going, in fact, even into suicide, or the need to murder the other person, because, and it does not solve your problem, because the feeling of rejection and the need for revenge is part of all investments of human nature. People kill each other even in businesses. So, but there are mitigating factors. That is why we counselors come in. That is why the church, the family, the society comes in. The society recognizes that things can go wrong. So instead, actually, of loving with your foot on the brake because you fear to be hurt, because you won't enjoy love to the full.
Right.
You love to the full. You love selflessly. So when you're hurt, you get this feeling of, I gave my all. It didn't work. I have no blame. I gave it all.
So where, how do we now get into the mind of maybe the offender in the story of love? For example, we have two, you know, couples, you know, and maybe one now goes out and cheats. These are people who are in love. What happens in the brain of this one that cheats, and looking at that point where they're coming from, where they were totally in love with this partner, what happens in the mind of the cheater? Is it that they fall out of love with this person and they look for this love elsewhere? What happens?
I'm going to surprise you.
Surprise us.
Cheating and love have very little connection. Cheating is a product of human weakness. Every human being has a capacity to cheat. And if you do not do anything, if you do nothing, a human being will cheat. Human beings are not naturally monogamous. Even those who fall in love and are marrying, they are still prone to temptation. And it depends on the amount of temptation. Mm-hmm. Everyone has a melting point.
Everyone has a melting point.
Yeah, depends on how much you are in love, how much you are free, how much disposable income you have, how much temptation is there. So cheating, actually, I always tell people, you have a cardinal responsibility to help your partner not to cheat.
How do you do it? And that's what someone would say, but simple. It is your weakness. How does it become me to protect you from doing something you know you shouldn't be doing?
If we put here 1 million shillings, if I have money, I will say, why should I steal 1 million shillings? It will bring me problems. I will not. I will pass by. But it's my weakness. I need money, but it's too little for my popularity, my fame. I find 10. Maybe I'll say, 10. I find 100. You see, my resistance will be breaking. If nobody is there, if there is no CCTV camera, if there is no, I will take the money and go and solve my problem. Similarly in love, if you have a partner, many people after church say, oh, I've finished. Look at the president. He captured power. He shed blood. But as soon as he sat, very many people wanted his seat. He doesn't leave and say, I am the president, so let me sleep. He is always looking for which rival is coming in. Mm. So you ask, what do you do? First of all, there are many things. That's a whole hour of talking, but summary is...
It's okay, we have an hour.
They are both what you call internal mechanisms and external mechanisms. Most people prefer external because it's easy to do. Like, take your phone, spy on them, make sure who are you calling. You know, external means of controlling someone. Make it clear that there are consequences. I will chase you away or I will beat you. Those are external. They work sometimes. But a person wants to cheat. Okay, like ringing a barbed wire around you. Mm. But they are also internal. And internal, people used to think that internal depends on this lover. To think, I am so loyal, so committed, cheating can bring diseases, can cost money, so let me leave it. So from internal, from inside you, you find a lot of reasons that make cheating inconveniencing, so you stop it. But the partner has a role to reinforce that internal belief. One, by showing you love. A lot of love, such that when you get tempted to cheat, you say, honestly, if I am caught this, I will have killed this person.
Like today, Valentine's. So on Valentine's.
No, hey, your partner doesn't forget Valentine's. Your partner, you come home, they are welcoming you well.
David.
Your partner is committed and you know he's showing you people. You feel so loved. But it doesn't stop temptation. No, temptation comes and internally you feel guilty. Some people react to guilt, others say, as long as I'm not going to be caught. Mm-hmm. That is one. Secondly, you can physically make it inconveniencing for your partner to cheat. For example, if she's my wife, I'm introducing her to everybody. At church, I'm making sure she takes a role. She goes either Mother's Union chairperson or, or church council. So now the members of the church know she's my wife. And this church community will also become me. When they see her with someone, they will frown. You, with your role in religion, you're searching, how do I cheat this man? Because people know you. So to cheat, I will have to travel, get out of town, go to Jinja, go to Italy, where people don't know me.
Yeah.
Over time, I will notice that it is very expensive. Because I have to travel, I have to give money to this person, we have to look for a lodge, we have to eat well. I come back and I find I have spent 5 bags of cement.
Ah, and you're building a house.
Then I say, but is this me? Is this working? Over time, I find cheating very inconveniencing. Why? Because I am well known in my community.
Mm.
So the community is like a policeman. It has no prisons. But people just looking at you and frowning makes you guilt and say, so that kind of way, they make you from internal fear cheating, find it inconveniencing, find it expensive. So you say, what the heck?
And if you're dating someone who is not known like David Rukasi,
So
I start putting him on my social media. Yes. Everyone needs to know about
him. Let's introduce him to people. This whole conversation, guys, is we finally have a trick. to kind of get the community to police on our behalf. Mm-hmm. Introduce this woman, this man, to every single person, the neighbors, the landlord, the chairman, LC1, LC2, 3, 4, 5, everyone you meet on the, this is my man. This is my woman. That's all I get. I think the community. But
that's one example.
But this is one question I have for you, doctor. Recently, we had a doctor here who, not Dr. Love, but we had a doctor who told us about blood types. O, A plus, O plus. And he said, well, not all blood types are meant to go to the gene. Is there an incident where there's maybe people that are not meant to be in love or fall in love or don't have any love within them? Is there a possibility that there are people who are not, who the word love and them don't fall in the same bracket?
Okay, we are over 7 billion people in this world. We believe in exceptions. When it happens, it can happen. But what I know is that all human beings were born with an urge, with a need for fulfillment. We are not loners. We are not loners. We have animals like leopards, like the eel. They live alone. They don't associate. They live alone even when they produce kids and young ones. After weaning them, they live alone. They have their territory. Human beings are not like that. That is why you get something nice, you want to tell it to someone. That's why you get a problem, you are shattered, you are stressed, and when you talk about it to someone who has no solutions but who just listens, you feel relieved. So now that makes us, we get fulfillment from an extra person. That is why solitary imprisonment becomes a very serious punishment. They can give you everything, food, everything, but the fact that you cannot talk to another human being, it can make you can run mad. That's in our nature. So love comes and comfortably takes over that vacuum. If people are there, they don't need love. Actually comes to help us, because love transcends social structures. So if there is no love, at least you will need someone you can confide in. And over time, those become like your brothers or your siblings, all the people who you can lay down your life to. And that then becomes a foundation of love. You see, love, maybe, let me say that the 7 billion people on earth define love 7 billion times. The way I know love to be might not be your style.
It's clearly not yet.
And that is fine. That is fine. It just takes experience and being together within society to synchronize these things.
Right.
Even in marriage, I can meet her, fall in love with her. Her view of a husband, her view of love might be different from mine. But marriage gives us an opportunity to synchronize, to discover that while I take this seriously, this person doesn't. So now, who changes? Do I reduce myself? You know, a system theory, a system to exist in equilibrium must have harmony. Whatever is high in one side, you either increase this side or you decrease the other high to fit the equilibrium. And marriage over time, because a 1-day marriage is not as strong as a 5-year-old marriage. You will look at passion and measure marriage by passion, but no, marriage is measured by the extent of adjustment to each other, to the concepts. Like, you see, love is not a well-defined situation that you can see and identify. It's a concept which then plays in the spiritual and physical, and you feel it. So you make your partner and yourself understand what love is over time.
Can love die? Doctor, can love die?
Yes, love can die. Love, that is one of the unfortunate things with love. Love is like life. It needs nourishment. You don't say, we love each other so much, let us relax. We have reached there. Love is a lifelong.
It's like a flower, you have effort.
You have to keep putting in work.
No, a flower withers after its work has
kept watering it.
So renovations that you take to a house.
Yeah, you need to keep it. You need, it's
it's like life. You need to eat. Mm-hmm. Some eat twice a day, others three times a day, others worse, but they live. You need to nurture it. It gets problems, you need to give it medicine. It gets hungry, you need to give it. You have to.
Now, and sometimes it gets too sick, you just need to.
But sometimes you can do all that, mm-hmm. and love will. Love is never for charity.
Mm.
I don't love you because I'm feeling sorry for you.
Oh.
I love you because I find value in you.
Mm.
And nobody, sometimes when lovers clash, they say, ah, I help you after all, right? That's not true. No one helps each other with love. Some you deserve, you earn someone's love. Now, over time, you can fail to fit in the person's expectations. Or a rival, that's why it's your duty. Because a rival can come in, and that rival is insignificant. But over time, their investment becomes bigger, and the person starts seeing.
Hiya.
The
intruder. They start putting in work.
So eventually the intruder takes the person. So love is actually stronger than us. We only fit in
to the little love that it is. Now away from that,
at you are nodding. It's not because I agree or I just can't believe some of the things you're saying. I'm just like this.
David, that is your opinion.
Old enough to understand that love is just old enough to be when it gets to see.
I'm looking forward to the time when. Because it will happen. Mm. It's just like breaking your virginity. You can delay it, but it will happen. Mm. You reach a time and say, this is the love we are talking about.
Yeah.
You will be flowered.
So as a way for David to have his love flowered, there's this bit where they tell women that they have such high standards because maybe they have a list of the partner they want. There's where you meet the partner and also the qualities you look for in a partner. Mm. And say, but that is such a long list. As long as the man can provide...
Yeah.
What else do you need? So is it having high standards if a woman has a list? Even if a man, David, men have lists of the women they would like to date and marry. So, doctor, let's talk about the list.
I will begin with myself. I had a list, a long list. Some of from books, others from parents, you know. But later, when I looked at my wife...
and looked at the list.
And I looked at the list, they were very different.
Yeah.
The list, even when I was training to be a counselor, we were told this should be on the list.
Mm.
Because of value addition, you must be relevant to a lover. You must add value in order to remain relevant. Now, from my experience of counseling, I've discovered that that list is not very... In fact, when you marry according to the list, you're marrying what someone has. Not what someone is.
Mm.
You see, ideally, you need to fall in love naturally. And we call it genetic attraction.
Or financial attraction.
Genetic. Okay, financial comes in, but it gets problems faster than genetic.
Mm.
Now, genetic is where every one of us has got a genetic component we inherited from parents. And as I told you, human beings are not loners. There is always a missing gap that you will find in someone so that your offspring becomes a better quality person than you. And we see in better quality, we are talking of immunity, we are talking ability to adjust to changes in the environment, we are talking about
IQ.
Intelligence, mm-hmm. things like that. Those are products of genes, the right genes. So, as a person, there are genes I miss. And inside me, the body knows it's actually looking for those genes. That's why I said at the beginning, we are walking billboards.
Mm-hmm.
When I see you, for me, I'll be liking maybe your height, your figure, but all those are telling my genes that this is what we have. If you have similar genes, you've seen someone and you don't feel attracted at all, and then there is someone who is dying for them and you're wondering why. It's not because they are not beautiful or presentable or attractive.
Right.
It's because you have similar genes. You cannot add value. You'll add value by 20-30%. So the body tells you
so
some things. Now, if they have money, and you go for them, yes, you'll marry, but one, you'll have kids who are always last in class. They are beginning to come, they are getting skin diseases, they are coughing, they easily get diseases. You travel, when you travel, they can't digest, they are sneezing, allergies, stuff like that. You use the wrong standard.
Mm.
But in modern society, people now marry for wrong reasons, you know,
right.
Because my siblings are going to get married, I need to be married first, or because that family is a rich family, or they have money, such things. But you know, even on the wedding day, you might find the best man is the lover of the bride. And they are genetically connected, but they are not going to produce offspring because when they fell in love, the best man was already married and stuff like that. But if you can marry a person and you add value to your offspring by 70s, 80s percent, it means that love occurred naturally. So things that bring people together, beauty, figure, are going to disappear soon. Things like passionate love, the love that makes you jealous, the love that makes you want sex all the time, they are going to die off, to wane off, and then be replaced by loyalty and
commitment.
Unity of purpose and commitment.
Mm.
Now, that commitment is played better when you are genetically linked, when you are value addition in terms of the genes you brought in the play for the offspring.
Okay.
Are better.
Doctor, at what point then do you walk out from a love relationship?
I think it depends. Okay, let's give it segments.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not yet married, you should walk out as soon, because dating is an opportunity to understand, are we compatible? Because you see someone on the side, so you start living closely, you start seeing whether they have similarities and whether the differences are not that big. So if you really find it uncomfortable at that level, it is better to walk out, because every day in a love is an investment.
Mm.
So if you break love on first, you have actually saved a lot than if you broke it on 15th.
Okay.
So the earlier, the better, because you're going to save. Every day you're investing emotions, you're investing resources, you're investing time, you're investing commitment, you're investing hope. So if you discover that it's not going to work, there are people who have high testosterone. Testosterone is a hormone that is an aggressive hormone.
Yeah.
If you do not have it, they are going to have to need sex all the time.
Okay. Scenario two, maybe.
Scenario two.
But I was going on. If it is after marriage, now marriage is a commitment. You will never marry a person who fits you 100%. Now it starts a journey of trying to adjust to your person and making that person adjust to you. So running out there, I think, is not advisable, because eventually, soon after, you'll get many stakeholders. Marriage is not a private affair. Children come in, your parents come in, both families come in, society comes in. And what you don't know in society, there are people who look at you and admire you. I want to be like that person. In a way, you are a good example to them. So when you break up, you're going to shatter many dreams. So,
but if there's infidelity and maybe there's abuse,
you are marrying a human being.
If there's abuse and infidelity, do they work out?
You see, first of all, you are marrying a human being.
Uh-huh.
You yourself, you're not perfect. You have your flaws, but unfortunately, because of love, you want your partner to be an angel. You tell lies, but you don't want them to tell lies. You hide money, but you want their money on the table. Sometimes you cheat, but when they cheat, you want to kill them.
Mm.
So that is human. Try as much as possible to understand, to forgive.
If there's abuse?
Yeah. Now, there are times, for example, if it becomes risky, because you must live to have an impact on life.
Okay.
If it becomes risky, like there is abuse, there is battering, there is infidelity where a person has started even getting children, it means they don't even protect themselves.
Mm.
They are going to bring the virus home. You're going to fall sick and die. If there is a risk on your life, first and foremost, that's when you say, no, I don't think it's going to work. And by the way, heartbreaks are very bad, but sometimes there is no way you can get a better person without leaving the current, because the current is a block. You can't get any person because there is a current. Mm. Once the current goes, you're freer to get a person you deserve. And sometimes God gives you a bad person so that you appreciate a better one.
Last question, Doctor. Is there a chance that I could love her and her at the same time? I love her for different qualities. Mm-hmm. Our genes, you remember the genes? For different qualities. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can clearly see I'm a dark man on this side. She's lighter, so I'm looking for probably to have lighter kids. And
sure?
Then on this side, you can clearly see the beauty on this side and tall and all that. So is there a scenario where I'm in love with two people?
Yes, there is. It is very possible. You see, people who say it's not possible.
Doctor, in 1 minute, maybe. Well, unfortunately, we are running out of time.
It is very possible. That's why you explain polygamy and stuff. Mm-hmm. Because I cannot love two people at the same time. I shouldn't say that you cannot. You can love several people at the same time.
Fine.
And it is possible, but not for everybody. Mm. There are people for whom it is possible. There are people for whom, when you love, you break the syringe. You can't use it again.
So you see, there's a possibility that I could be in love with three of you women out there. Okay. So when I tell you that I love you, but you're three, don't. This, I'm not lying.
It's the truth. It's a polygamous kind of
thing. I have my hand in my cheek because if anyone
I'm just saying that it's a truth. The doctor just said it's
gone. Yes, love does surely rain today. And remember, it is happy Valentine's to you. It is Valentine's Day. From what Dr. Love has said, love is clearly defined in very different ways according to different people. So maybe you could always express to your partner what love is defined in your terms to avoid you complaining and saying he doesn't love me, what happened?
And maybe he loves you, but you don't see it in that
in that mind. And also do know that you can be adding value to the person in the relationship you're with. For those that would like to go to locations such as church to pick their partners, Dr. Love has said churches are not a garden where you just go and pick a flower. Yeah. Or even a plant, or even any fruit, okay? Morning at NTV does come to an end. Happy Valentine's from all of us. David is going to try and take us to lunch, and hopefully love will rain.
Both of them. So
I wish everyone happy Valentine's. Please do something. Even if it is small, do something. It's your day of love. It's her day. It's his day. Don't be selfish. It's not about money. It's not about time. Do something.
Okay.
Today is the day of love. I wish you happy Valentine's.
The Dr. Love himself, Mr. Hilary Joseph Bainyundisha. Thank you so much for joining us on Morning at TV. Happy Valentine's.
Happy Valentine's.
Happy Valentine's.
Are you dreaming of longer and thicker hair? Or of long and natural eyelashes? Try Placent Active Hair Growth products that are suitable for both natural and relaxed hair. Available at all the biggest pharmacies and beauty shops.